Well, it's interesting. I mean, most people know about AI, but they don't really understand what the generative side of that means. And what it means is it's a way to use what's called large language models, the way to interact with data and information in a way that is more natural to us, but also in a way that as you ask questions, it generates answers, and you can ask clarifying questions, and it generates more focused answers. So the generative part of AI is really the exploration of going into the models in a very natural way to get the answer that we're looking for. The models themselves are these things called large language models and foundation models, which are really, consider them sort of like someone that's gone to university, high school, university, grad school, and they've been trained on a corpus of data, and they've learned how to learn. And so now you're taking that individual type of model that's smart and knows how to learn and pointing them towards your data, and then you're asking questions based on that and getting answers back on their knowledge. So it really comes down to a way to iteratively get out data and information from the existing systems in a way that is much less siloed than it is today. It's actually an interesting spectrum. If you look at where the clients are looking at Gen AI, there's a maturity curve from, you know, throw holy water on it, we're scared of it, to we're all in. I think mostly they're trying to understand what it means, and it's starting in the IT shops, which is natural. But what we try to walk them through is this is actually going to touch all parts of your organization. And it really becomes a big change moment for organizations. And I think executives need to get ahead of that a little bit to make sure that they're communicating that to their people, that this isn't a thing that's going to replace jobs. It's going to help you do your jobs more efficiently. And I think that's the big thing we're dealing with is around where are you on that maturity curve? How quickly do you want to adopt the technology? But more importantly, us giving recommendations to our clients of, A, where you should and should not start now because there's a lot of false information out there, what you can do, but also what partners they should pick, what use cases we've seen that have already been deployed and worked, and then really looking at those use cases for the individual companies that can really move the needle for them. It's interesting. I think a lot of the use cases we're seeing, there's the low-hanging use cases, which are really around knowledge retrieval, customer interaction. These are things that generative is really good at right now and frankly is ready for prime time. And I'll walk through some of those examples. But there's also areas of in the creative side, which doesn't really apply to us as much, though we are starting to use some of that in some of the oil field services demos that we've done. But it really comes down to how can I take the data that's locked in different data stores that provide information to either an end-use worker or a customer and present that in a way that looks across the data stores and they can ask generative questions around what's my bill going to be like? Can I get a different payment system? All these different things, you know, a payment scheme. That's one thing. So really this iterative idea of pulling data together. There are core IT use cases that are ready for prime time. Things like looking up HR policies, getting to the right place to do that, dealing with self-help, starting to deal with payroll questions. Those things that you just naturally would do that have process. So anything that has knowledge retrieval is something that's really unique. I think the idea of anything that has a defined process and is filling in forms and information is really good. And then really the customer interactions, the idea of interacting with a customer either pre or post conversation, whether it's in through email or through chat, or even as we're talking to them online, the capability there is really pretty amazing to tailor to a customer. With clients, we're trying to take them through a process because this is all new to them. While they have AI and they have machine learning today, what they don't have is the idea of what does generative mean. So we're starting with this idea of coming in with how you would structure a team, how you'd prioritize use cases, how you test those use cases. We call it explore, expand, and execute. So you want to explore standing up the capabilities. And there's some unique capabilities around this, like how do I secure the environment? Because obviously OpenAI externally is not secure for my data. How do you, who should be involved in that from an organizational perspective? How do we come up with use cases, both some of the ones we talked about earlier that are easier, but also some of the more complex ones? And then how do we execute them within the organization? So we're trying to bring that structure to our clients. We're trying to bring some of the insight of use cases that we've already done to the clients and also bring partnerships with our ecosystem partners to help them frankly, accelerate that value proposition. The challenges with generative AI that can be solved short-term are simply the low-hanging fruit of knowledge retrieval and information to employees and customers. That's sort of the easy one. But where it gets more interesting is really the idea of solving long-term, easier ways to do our jobs. In other words, I like the idea that Microsoft calls it a co-pilot. I think it's a great analogy in that a co-pilot, it sits next to the pilot, they can fly the plane, but they're sort of giving information to the pilot that the pilot then validates. And that's the, if you think about it in that way, if you think about if you're a customer service agent or if you're a billing agent or if you're a procurement person or a manufacturing person, that your little co-pilot friend is with you all the time saying, based on what I know, I think this is what we should do. And do you agree? And you say yes, and it does it. And it does it in the back-end systems without you ever going into them. And that's the cool part. Well, it goes back to the idea, enterprise reinvention is really around how do you take those core, digital core systems and then surround them with capabilities that drive unique value for the company. And this is where generative AI, I think, can be really clear. You don't mess with the core systems. You keep the digital core clean. You expose that information and you expose it across the organization to give a different insight and to the end user and or the customer. And I think generative AI has a really great way of for us to keep things siloed, but still giving new and better insight to those end users. And this is something we will see rapidly be adopted over the next 12 to 24 months. The energy transition in generative AI is really an area that's starting to get really exciting. Because if you think about all the things that go into making those decisions of how we move to a more net zero type of environment, to also how do we make decisions based on criteria that are around us, whether those be environmental, physical, technical, the ability for it to pull together and make recommendations based on how we're going to apply that to our organization or to our customers is really, really amazing. So you can imagine you're doing something and you're getting a recommendation based on how we've set our strategy around transitioning, energy transition. And it's saying to us, based on this, we would recommend you do this. And here's why. And it's going to be, it'll help our carbon score. It'll help whatever. It can make those recommendations as you're making decisions to really align with the company's goals and or the broader geo goals. Well, ecosystem innovation, Gen AI is, I think, how's it going to accelerate it is really something we are just at the tip of, but it's going to be massive. Because the idea for us to be able to say, if I have a core ecosystem partner and I'm looking at how I'm going to get the most value out of that asset, but that asset doesn't tie into other ecosystem partners today, the ability for it to sort of look across and give me new insight and value into my organization is a capability that doesn't come natively with the ecosystem partner. Now, our ecosystem partners are going to come with their own versions of this. And so we need to start to think through how do we weave that together in an API model and where do we present that information to the end user, so the employee. And that's likely going to be in a Microsoft Teams or an Outlook or a Power BI or Excel, somewhere where we're doing our work. We're not going to go back in the back end system. So how do we take all those ecosystem products and pieces and functions and pull them together to really drive enhanced and shift left value of those systems in a way that we couldn't have done in the source systems themselves. Well, if success when it comes to Gen AI, and we look, is really I think it's a holistic approach across the board. This is not something that is just an IT thing. And some companies that are thinking it that way are going to miss the boat and miss the value. So this, it really takes leadership from the top level down to say, how are we going to look at this and how are we going to measure and communicate this to our employees? So for me, it takes an outside in thinking. And this is not easy for the data and AI folks, right? Data and AI folks are usually very analytical and very siloed, and they're very much, we can't do that because this model doesn't, very, standard in their ways. They need to be more creative. This needs to be pulling in the business side because the businesses are going to come up with the use cases. And so it really takes an organization that empowers their people to make those decisions, to really think about those outside the box use cases, because the core data groups won't do that. They will be very much, it can't do this. Boom, so we're not going to do it. Well, maybe it can't do it today, but the rapid development of generative AI means it might be able to do it in a month. And so I think it's really important from the organizations look at it in a way that this is a culture change. And it is going to be a huge change agent in both how you do work, but also how you encourage your folks to use it to do what you do for your clients and your customers and your employees better than you do today.